appreciate your words, Paul, and Brett, concerning our military people. Kelly just came in. I think she's the only active duty military person we have. Kelly, stand up. Where are you? I'd go back in, but they won't have me. What?
They have an age cut off.
I probably doubled their age cut off already.
Laws are just too good looking.
Yeah, that's
it.
Yeah. Good to have all of you here. I know this is a holiday weekend and we've got some good jobs, but it's great to see each of you here. And we just pray that as they're on the road that they'll be safe and have a great weekend just to get away and enjoy themselves. This morning we're going to be taking a little bit of a break from 1 Corinthians. And we're going to be taking a little bit of a break even from the study of spiritual gifts. You know, last week we finished 1 Corinthians 14, which means we're going to go into spiritual gifts now in other portions of Scripture. Then we'll come back to 15 and finish 1 Corinthians. But some very timely information has come to my attention this week, and I feel like that I really need to deal with that today, and I want to take the time to do that. So we'll hopefully be back on spiritual gifts next Sunday. A few days ago, a gentleman shared some verses of Scripture with me that are the main passages that homosexuals use to justify their lifestyle as being in keeping and pleasing to the will of God. Now, this is firsthand information from a faithful Christian who has had the opportunity to minister to homosexuals for several years. He's actually attended homosexual churches for the purpose of ministry, and therefore the verses that he shared with me were verses that he has actually heard taught in homosexual churches. Verses that are taught to justify homosexuality and the lesbian lifestyle. Now, needless to say, this excited me a lot because what he shared with me was new information to me. I had not had access to this kind of information before. And so I really got excited when he started sharing these particular verses. And I got excited by going and looking at those and then trying to just evaluate, okay, what do these verses really say? What does the Bible really say about this subject? Because there are many people who are in the homosexual lesbian lifestyle today that they are taught that they are Christians and pleasing to God and in keeping with God's will. And they are taught that they're just as good, their church is just as good in favor with God as anyone else's church. And so there's a lot of deception out there, and I think it's important for us to look at this so that we can sort of straighten some of that out. My first thought was to share this with the Tuesday night Bible study, and I did. And we had a really, really good study. But the thing that struck me when we finished was the fact that I should have done it on Sunday morning instead of Tuesday night. Because when I first opened up Tuesday night, I asked the question, what are the verses of Scripture that homosexuals and lesbians base their activity on as being acceptable to God and saying that they're Christians just like anyone else? And the whole room was blank. No one knew any. And if I'd have been asked that question before the gentleman shared with me a few days ago, I would have been just as blank. I know verses that we would share and talk about to say it's not right, it's not God's will, but I didn't know any that they teach and stand on as confirming that they're in the will of God. So when I realized all of this last week, I realized that that this needed to be taught to the larger community of our church. And so I'm doing something today that I wouldn't normally do, and that is cover today what we covered on Tuesday night. There's a little bit of shifting around with it, different format and all, but pretty much covering the same information. And I'm doing it for those of you that were not there Tuesday night. I believe this is important information for us as we put ourselves in the right position as our nation and as our state is facing this whole issue of same-sex marriage. This is huge. This is as huge as abortion in 1973. This is huge. And our nation and our state is facing what we're going to do in this, and we need to be in a position as Christians to know where we stand and why we stand there. So I want to share these verses with you, the verses that they use to condone their activity and say that it is godly. And then I want to share just a few verses with you that show us that the Scripture says the opposite of that, very plainly. And you're going to see when we look at the verses they use that they really stretch the verses. They really tweak the verses. They go to these verses and they come to them from a perspective that's not even there in the verses. And what I found most interesting was that I have read these verses as I've read through the Bible many times before. And only once in all my years of studying Scripture, and that was just a week and a half ago, did I ever read across these verses I'm going to share with you this morning and had even a remote thought that this could say something to someone to justify homosexuality and lesbianism. But that thought did cross my mind when I read one of them the other day. I thought, oh, I wonder if this is a verse that they use. And sure enough, that was one of the verses. So that was a pretty unique situation for me. But I think that we can read these things and not even pick up on where they're coming from. That's how much they twist these verses of Scripture and make them say what they want them to say. Now, after we share the few verses that condone their action, I want to share some verses, and we can share a lot more. But a few verses that very plainly condemn their action and say it's not acceptable to God and not pleasing to God. So we're not going to have the time to read from each of these verses. I'm just going to state where it is, and I'm going to share the gist of what it is in that verse, and then share the specific thing that they pick out in each of these verses. So let's begin with 1 Samuel 18, 1 through 4. You might want to just jot these down instead of trying to turn to them. It may be more cumbersome trying to do that, and you'll not hear what's being said. Then you can go back and read these this afternoon or sometime this week. 1 Samuel chapter 18, verses 1 through 4. This verse speaks of the soul of Jonathan. This was King Saul's son. And David, as they were knit together, as the Scripture talks about in that verse of Scripture. And then it says, the soul of Jonathan being knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved David as himself. Jonathan made a covenant with David, and in so doing, Jonathan, and listen to this, stripped himself of his robe and gave it to David along with his armor, including his sword, his bow, and his belt. Now, what this is here is an example of brotherly love. These two men had gone through things together. They were in military together. They were in positions of leadership in Israel together. And they just had this connection. And it's also characteristic of things that was done in that day and time in the process of making a covenant, coming into a covenant relationship with another person. Now, when you consider those two things, it's a real stretch here to say that he loved him as he loved himself and say that's homosexual love. These two men had a homosexual relationship. Yet this is what is taught from this verse of Scripture regularly, so I'm informed by one who's been there and heard it, that this is right and it's in Scripture and it's pleasing to God. because of this verse of scripture that they say here. Now, you say, well, that does sound a little funny about the fact that he stripped his robe. You can read in other places in the New Testament that say the exact same thing. And all in the world that's referring to is the outer garment came off. It wasn't a stripping of all his clothes. He still was clothed, but the outer garment came off. And he gave it, his sword, his bow, and all as part of this covenant relationship that he and David had gone into. So you can see the stretch there. And, you know, I've said before that if you take any verse of Scripture and you tweak it, take it out of context, do all the things you want to do to distort it, you can pretty much prove anything if you take Old Testament and New Testament. Somewhere you can find something, if you'll twist it and tweak it enough, that you can say, oh, this is justified, this verse of Scripture says it. But is that really what the verse of Scripture is talking about? And I say to you today, no, that's not what this verse of Scripture is saying. 1 Samuel 20, 1 through 4. This speaks of David getting help from Jonathan to determine whether Saul was really trying to kill him. Now, verse 4 says this, "Then Jonathan said to David, whatever your soul says, I will do for you." Now, to take that verse of Scripture and make that say that Jonathan was saying that whatever homosexual act David wanted him to do, he would do for him. That's what they're saying. And to me, that's a humongous stretch to say that you could twist that out of that verse of Scripture. I mean, you could name a 100 things that would go in there, you know, just as well as another. And that was not what was being said here, I contend, but yet that's what they say. So it seems like here they're just making the Scripture say what they want it to say instead of allowing Scripture in its context to say what it means. And this is done by a lot of people under the name of Christianity and biblical scholarship and all of those things. So that's pretty flimsy, it seems to me. Now, 1 Samuel 20, 14 through 17. This speaks of the covenant vow that Jonathan and David made because of his love for him, Jonathan's love for David. Now, it goes on and says, because he loved him as he loved his own life. Now, they take this and automatically say, this is homosexual love. Love is not always sexual. Okay? I realize that we live in a society today that the two terms are almost synonymous in a lot of people's minds. Love, sex, same thing. But it's not. There are many kinds of love that we can have and have nothing to do with a sexual involvement. Yet at the same time, there is love that has to do with sexual involvement. Sexual involvement which God created us to be involved in, the way He made us, male and female, the institution of marriage that He set up, all of those things. He made us that way, and He made us to enjoy those things as well as continue populating the earth. But to simply say, every time you see the word love in the Bible, okay, that means homosexual activity, is just ludicrous, really. But yet, this is something that is put forward. Now, you can find many people, and as they were honoring the military this morning, and I appreciate that so much again, but you can find many people, particularly that have been men or women that have gone through combat together. They've gone through some difficult thing in the military together. And you will find a bond and a connection and a love between those two men or those two women that is powerful and strong. But it doesn't mean it's homosexual or lesbian. You see what I'm saying? Jonathan and David had gone through things together. They were both military men in Saul's army at one time together. And so, you know, just just to say that he loved him as he loved his own life is no more than to say that he'd be willing to die for him. Right? I mean, how many times have you heard someone say, I love this person enough that I'd be willing to die for them? How many military people have loved this nation enough and the people in this nation enough to go give their life? That mean they were homosexuals? Because they had that kind of love? Absolutely not. Okay, 1 Samuel chapter 20, verses 41 and 42. 1 Samuel 20, 41 and 42. Notice all of these are coming from one book of the Bible. Well, there'll be two when we see it all. And it's all Old Testament. And again, it's all being tweaked and tweaked and tweaked. Now, this speaks of the day Jonathan reported to David that Saul was trying to kill him. Remember, he had the boy go out, shoot the arrows. They had all that little thing planned. And so, when David came out, he knew then that the message had come that Saul was really trying to kill him. So they were going to part. They probably were never going to see each other again. And so, it says in Scripture that they parted and they kissed each other and wept together, but David wept the more. Now, let's think about that for a minute. Here's two men, and the Bible says they kissed each other. Well, if your mind is in that direction, you could come up with some kind of homosexual activity here if that's the bent of your mind. But look at the custom of that day. The custom of that day to kiss, and in some countries still today, I think, Dave, France maybe. You've been to France. That's a normal greeting, just like hugging or shaking hands. And if you don't think that's enough to justify this kiss not having to mean that it was homosexual, Mark 14:44 talks about Judas betraying Jesus. Judas came up to Jesus to point him out as the man they needed to arrest, the soldiers he led up to him. And the scripture is very plain. He kissed him. Now, that simply means that was a normal greeting. And he used that to be the thing that would say, this is the man you want. But it wasn't anything unusual. And we certainly don't say, aha, Jesus and Judas were homosexual lovers. Do we? Okay. That's what would be being said to take this scripture the way it was said here, that they kissed each other and wept. Now, this next one, 2 Samuel 1, 25 through 27. 2 Samuel 1, 25 through 27. This speaks of the day that David found out that Saul, King Saul, and Jonathan his son, and the one that David had come into this covenant relationship with, had been killed in battle. And David was very distressed over the death of both of them. And one of those that he was very distressed over was, of course, Jonathan and the relationship that they had had and the covenant that they had made with one another. Now, if you've never heard covenant taught or you've never did a study on covenant in the Old Testament, it's a powerful thing. It is two people going into a relationship and a promise and a statement that is beyond most anything that we have today other than marriage. It is a covenant to say, not only will I give everything I have to you if you need it and vice versa, no longer would I would lay down my life for you and vice versa in that, but not just you, but your whole family. And not just your family now, but if something happens to you and I'm still alive and I'm in covenant with you, then I'm going to care for your kids, your grandkids, or whoever else. I mean, this is something that is powerful. And they usually seal it with a statement to say, if I break this covenant, then I speak now, and they give this long list of curses that will come upon me and my family and all my descendants and everything I am and hope to be. This is not something done like had come into this covenant relationship together. And here, Jonathan is dead. And this is what how it affects David. David says in these verses, "Your love to me was more wonderful than the love of women." Now, this is clearly their strongest verse to argue of some sexual relationship here. But I want you to think about this for a minute. I want you to think about how honest the Bible is. This is talking about David. Think about what the Bible says about David. David had a man in his army killed so that he could continue his adulterous, sinful relationship with Uriah's wife, whose name was Bathsheba. And then after he had him killed, he married her. And the Bible did not pull one punch on that. It laid it out there just as rotten as it was. Now, my point in all of that is this. If David and Jonathan, if that's what this meant here in terms of more wonderful than the love of a woman, and they had a homosexual relationship, then the Bible would say Jonathan and David had a homosexual relationship. Because there's no place in Scripture, New Testament or Old Testament, where the Scripture backs off from telling it like it is about any person or character or situation that's in Scripture. And this one concerning David is certainly one of those. I mean, he names him a murderer and an adulterer. Why wouldn't he, if he was a homosexual, name him a homosexual? You see what I'm saying? It doesn't add up. It doesn't make sense. And so there's a situation in which there's probably someone that has a relationship with someone that is more important, we could say, to them than maybe any relationship they ever had with a woman. Doesn't necessarily mean they're homosexual or lesbian, vice versa. But it means that this is a powerful, important relationship to them. But I would encourage you to just think about these things. And this is what they base their action on. And this is what a lot of people are saying. I am a Christian. I am a practicing homosexual or lesbian. I am in a church. And I am just as godly and acceptable to God and on my way to heaven just as much as anyone else who claims to be a Christian. Now, if that's true, then they're okay. But if the Bible shows us that's not true, and that all this stuff that they're saying here is just flimsy and tweaked and abused so much to come up with what they wanted to say, then that word needs to be put out. Why? Because a lot of people are deceived, thinking they're living pleasing to God when they're living, as we're going to see in a moment, as an abomination in His sight. So, with all of that said on that side, let's go now to just a few verses of Scripture, and we could go with many more, but for time's sake, we're just going to go with a few. A few verses of Scripture that actually clearly condemn the homosexual lesbian lifestyle. Now, these verses of Scripture just speak it forth. It takes no tweaking. It takes no one with a big degree in theology or something to determine what it's saying. It doesn't even take a lot of knowledge in the Greek. This is just straightforward. Everything that we're going to look at here, it just speaks clearly about God's view concerning this. And I think you're going to see the difference of the way they twisted and tweaked and added and shaped it to speak what they want, as over against what we're going to look at now. And it just lays it out there. Here is God's opinion on this subject. And like I say, we could multiply this with other verses. Let's go first to Romans 1, 24 through 27. And let's also note something too, that most of the verses I'm going to give you now, with the exception of one, are all New Testament, where all of theirs were Old Testament. That says something right there. in verse, Romans chapter 1, verses 24 through 27, the whole chapter talks about this a lot, or the last part of it, but we'll just consider these verses. It speaks of people committing idolatry. And idolatry is worshiping something other than God. It talks about worshiping the creature rather than the Creator. And because they had committed idolatry, God, the scripture says, gives the people over. The ones that had committed idolatry, He gives them over to homosexual and lesbian lifestyles. And it comes in the order of He allows this to happen in their life because of their idolatry, and it's allowed in their life as a form of punishment. And that's a very interesting concept if you want to read those verses. Now, these practices, the practices of homosexuality and lesbianism, this is how they're referred to, how these sexual acts are referred to in this passage in Romans. Degrading passions. Unnatural. Indecent acts. Impure. Dishonorable. And it refers to the lifestyle as one as being lived in error. Now that just plainly says God's not pleased with this lifestyle. And it doesn't take rocket science to figure this out. It is very clear that the Word of God is saying these things, this is how I see them. And there's not one positive description there. Okay? Now let's go to another. 1 Corinthians 6, 9 through 11. This gives a list of sins that have not repented from and cleansed by faith in Jesus Christ will cause those who live such a lifestyle to not inherit the kingdom of God. And that plainly means to not go to heaven, and the other alternative is only, of course, hell. Now, out of the list that he gives here, and it's not just the one word in the list, but out of the list, in these verses, homosexuality is one of those sins. It's just one of those. And I would encourage you to read all the rest of them. But this is one of them. And it says, and what it's referring to here, the person that lives this type of lifestyle, any of the other sins listed there, or the homosexual lifestyle, lives this type of lifestyle in a practicing lifestyle in a continual basis throughout their life, they're not right with God. They're not going to go to heaven when they die. Now, I must say this. God loves every homosexual and every lesbian just as much as He loves anyone else. You, me, or anyone else. And the other sins in this list are sins that have not repented from and washed in the blood of Jesus will send somebody to hell also. So we're not just coming out here and making a big deal about homosexuality. There's a whole list here. And there are other lists in Scripture. But this is just, it brings this particular one out in this case. Now my point is this. Jesus died for every homosexual and lesbian. And the desire of Jesus' heart is to have them recognize their sin, turn from that sin, and accept Him as Lord and Savior. Just like you and I had to do for the sins that we had committed. So we're not putting these people off in some bad camp over here. We're just trying to tell the truth about what the Bible says in hopes that people will not continue to be deceived by the false things that are being taught. You see what I'm saying? We have all sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, those who have sinned, as all of us have, and have not had that cleansed and washed in the blood of Jesus through repentance and faith in Him, they will be elbow to elbow with people in hell who are homosexuals or lesbians. You see what I'm saying? So it's not just, oh, you're just down on these people. No, I'm speaking about sin. of which we're, God wants to cleanse us all. And He paid the price through Jesus dying on the cross to take our sins from us if we will turn from sin and place faith and trust in Him. So you see what I'm saying here. I'm not just coming down on this particular sinful activity, but I'm just saying that we need to let the Scripture speak, and it surely needs to speak in this area, because these people are misusing Scripture. They're being taught lies, and they're being deceived into believing they're okay with God when the Scripture is clear that they're not. But we're not trying to bash them any more than any of the other sins in this list, or make them any more accountable to God or sinful before God than you and I before we were washed in the blood of Jesus. Do you see that? Please see that. Don't take this as some misguided, off the wall, just pick on some certain group thing. Now, 1 Timothy 1:8-11. This verse of Scripture categorizes homosexuality in these manners, with these words: lawless, rebellious, ungodly, sinners, unholy, and profane. Again, clearly these are all negative. There's not one thing here that is saying that God or the Bible condones this activity. In every case, it's no. It's unholy, ungodly, profane. Yet, the homosexuals are saying with the verses that we looked at earlier that no, their action is godly. And they can be accepted and just as faithful to God as a Christian as anyone else. And they are being deceived. Now, for sake of time, we've only got one more verse. And it's from the Old Testament. I want you to listen to this one carefully. Leviticus 18:22 teaches that homosexuality is an abomination. And what that is saying is that it is a detestable, hated thing. Homosexuality and lesbianism is a detestable, hated thing in the eyes of God. Remember Sodom and Gomorrah. And I was reminded this morning, there were more sins than just that in Sodom and Gomorrah that brought it down. But that was one of the major ones. But if you read further, we don't have time to do it. I want you to do it on your own. But if you read further in this same passage in Leviticus 18:22 and then the verses following, it says some interesting things. It says that homosexuality defiles the person who commits it. It defiles the person who commits it. Then it says it defiles the nation where it is committed. Now, our nation is going 900 miles an hour right straight toward condoning and promoting and saying this is a fine alternate lifestyle. And the Bible says where the nation commits this, they are defiling the land. So, they defile themselves as they commit it, they defile their nation, and they defile the land in which their nation dwells. Then it goes on to point out the result is punishment, and this is the way it states it. The land will spew out its inhabitants. That's a very picturesque term. The land will spew out its inhabitants. And if you'll go back and look at this, you will realize that this is exactly what happened in the Old Testament. The nations that God took the land from and gave to Israel. Do you know why He did it? Go back and read it carefully. Because of the sins they were committing. And this was one of them. And it was like the land spewing out the inhabitants because they had committed those sins. Their land was taken from them and given to Israel. Now, listen carefully. Don't be fooled. if Jesus Christ waits very long in his return for the church, and if this nation does not turn around and continues going down the same road it's going down now, there will be a day in which this nation, the land, will, because of this spiritual sin, will spew out its inhabitants. And there will be another group of people living in what was the United States of America, the land of the free, the home of the brave, and all of those things that we have enjoyed blessing by living here. God will see to it. Now, I'm not a prophet, but that's prophecy that will come to pass if Jesus tarries long enough and if this nation doesn't turn around. Jesus could come and take the church and there's not enough time to make it happen. Or this nation could turn around and get back right with God. But you can take it to the bank. If those two things don't happen and this nation continues to promote just this sin alone, not counting all the others that we're putting forth, but this sin alone, promoting homosexuality, lesbianism, same-sex marriage, making it acceptable by law, the law pushing it as it's being done, the law making people hire people who practice this lifestyle, the law pushing it with all of its force. Do you know that this United States of America right now is seeking to force nations in the world that do not accept and condone this lifestyle? We're seeking to use our military and what financial power, I don't know, they think we have, but our influence to cause nations to start doing exactly what we're doing that are not doing that. The government is pushing this agenda. And what I'm saying is this: if that does not change, God will see to it that the inhabitants of this nation will be spewed out of the land and somebody else will take it over. China just about owns us now anyway.
Yeah.
So we're not far from this. I believe Jesus will come before it happens. But it will happen, and God will see to it if this nation doesn't change or Jesus doesn't come before. Now, what should be our response in this? Well, first of all, as always, if you have never acknowledged your own sin, whether it be homosexuality, lesbianism, drunkenness, lying, cheating, stealing, adultery, on and on. Idolatry. If you've never recognized your own sin and turned from that sin and given your life to Jesus Christ, then you are not going to inherit the kingdom of heaven in the condition you're in. That's plainly what the Bible says. But if you will turn from that sin and you will give your life to Jesus, He will wash you and cleanse you of all of that sin. And it doesn't matter what kind it is. It can be what we're talking about this morning or anything else. And we need to realize that that is the only thing that will cleanse any of us from the sin we've committed against God. So first of all, I would encourage you, look at your own life, and if you need to accept Christ, then please do so today. Secondly, if you are a Christian through faith in Christ, and you look at your life, now listen carefully to this, you look at your life and you are continually walking in a lifestyle of sin in some area or maybe several areas, then there's two things you need to realize if you think you're a Christian and you're walking in a lifestyle of sin, whether it's the homosexuality, lesbianism, or any of the other sins we just named. And this is the practice of your life. If you're truly a Christian, Hebrews chapter 12 makes it clear that God is disciplining you, and He's disciplining you severely. And he's doing it because you're his child through faith in Christ, and because he loves you, and he loves you too much to leave you living in the sin you're living in. It's something you need to realize, and if you fall into that category, you need to repent from that today as a believer and get the strength and the power of God to stop living in the sin that you're living in day after day. Listen to the other part of this. If you think you're a Christian and you're living in sin, whether homosexuality, lesbianism, whatever, and God is not disciplining you, then you need to know one thing. Whatever it is that has made you think you're a Christian, you have been deceived, because you are not one. Why? Because Hebrews 12 makes it clear that God disciplines those who are his own children to bring them back to the right way. But those that are not his children are illegitimate children, and they receive none of God's discipline. What that translates is this. There are people in the world today who think, I am right with God, I am on my way to heaven. But they're living in a lifestyle of practicing some type of sin. And they're receiving none of God's discipline. They are happy in the life that they're living. They're confident in all of these things. And the scripture screams out to that person, you are deceived. You are not right with God. And that's the category that many of these people fall into. They're going to church. They're doing churchy things. But they're living in a lifestyle of practicing homosexuality and lesbianism, and their church condones it and says, you can go to heaven, you can be a preacher, you can be a missionary, you can teach Sunday school, you're just as good a Christian as anyone else. And it's a lie. And if they're being disciplined by God for it, then that may be an indication they have a relationship with God. But if they're happily living their life without that discipline, they have been deceived. And they will not enter the kingdom of heaven in the condition that they're in. And these people need to know that. We've got to understand that they need to hear the truth. Even at the risk of us looking harsh. One last thing. If you're a Christian and you are tolerating, or you're having a tolerant attitude toward this sin, that's what the nation's saying right now. Tolerate it. If you don't want to do it, that's fine, but tolerate those who do. Allow it. It's a perfectly fine alternative lifestyle. If you're a Christian and you're tolerating that, that's your position. Well, that's what the nation wants to do, let it happen. Then you need to change your mind, and you need to do as the scripture says and begin to stand in defense of the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which he has entrusted with each one of us. Romans chapter 1 ends, verse 32, talking about the bad position that people will be in because they condone this sin in other people's lives. Don't vote for the politicians that condone it. Don't support any church that condones it, because it's becoming rampant. A ministry that has been used for many decades to minister to children all around the world. World Vision. Just recently, their board came out and said, we are going to allow same-sex couples to work for us, to serve in our ministries. Are you shaking your head no on that?
You know,
they reversed that. I'm going to say that. But they came out and said that. Okay? They came out and said that. And the upheaval from the Christian people that had supported that ministry so long, caused them to refigure it. And the board said, well, we've decided that we shouldn't do that. Belita and I have been giving to that organization for 30 years. What did we do? She called them and told them why, and we quit. And they kept sending us letters. And she called them again and told them why. And we're not going to send them another penny. You say, but they turned around. They changed. No, no. Their heart was to say, we're going to go with this and condone it and promote it by hiring the people to do ministry in our organization. That was the heart of their board. Because they are losing so much money, they changed their mind. Their pocketbook voted and changed their mind. The people's heart hadn't changed that made the decision. And so we just found another organization that's not doing something like that to give to. But this is what I'm talking about. There is a push in this nation now for Christians to tolerate, to accept, to condone, and to act like there's nothing wrong with this lifestyle. But you can take this to the bank. If this lifestyle persists in this nation, as I said before, Jesus doesn't return soon, and if the nation doesn't turn around, and this lifestyle persists, it will be one of the major things that brings the absolute collapse and destruction of this nation. It's happened in nations before, and it will happen in this nation if we don't wake up and do something about it. Now, the problem is simply this. There is probably not one single thing you and I can do about it other than pray, live right ourselves, and don't fall into the condoning of this. Why do I say that? I say it simply because I believe we're so close to the end that this nation and other nations have got to fall far below where they have been to bring in the Antichrist, the last 7-year tribulation. We're so close to that that there's not going to be a turnaround. And no matter what we did, wouldn't turn it around. I'm not being pessimistic, I'm being realistic. Jesus is coming soon. And the nations of the world are going to fall into chaos and collapse so that the Antichrist can come in and supposedly solve the whole problem and take over. And so there's got to be a downturn sometime. And I believe that we're in it now. But that does not take away from you and I as individual Christians and a church, as this members of this church, we must stand for what the Bible says, no matter what the government says. If things don't change, a sermon like this today could get me in prison. If things don't change, you'll see it happen. And if Jesus doesn't come soon, because this will be considered a hate crime. It's not a hate crime at all. Listen to me carefully as I close. Love, real love, is not allowing people to continue to live in sin and deception. True love will warn someone. You see what I'm saying? So the people that are saying, be tolerant, live with it, let it happen like it is, and keep your mouth shut as a Christian, they don't know anything about love. Because love will want to warn them. No love will say, go on, do it, go to hell for all I care. You see what I'm saying by that? This is a serious issue. And I just felt like, particularly from the information that was given to me firsthand with those verses of Scripture, I was so thankful to get that. And then to pursue those verses and all. And then to just allow us at this crucial time in our state's history and in our nation's history that we as Christian people and we as this church have got to be on the right side of this issue. And I don't know how much you know it or not, but there are denominations right now saying, let them become preachers, let them be accepted in the church, let them be married in the church, and then there are others that are, they're saying no, and so those groups are splitting. There are already people who are in the wedding business, caterers for flowers and cakes and red carpets and all those other things, you know, that because they're not willing to do it for homosexual couples in the states where that has been approved and accepted, they're being carried to court because of that. And here again, it'll be the same thing. Before you know it, some couple will come to me or some other preacher and say, I want you to marry us. And I will say no. And the next thing is, I will find out I'm being drawn up to court. It's bad. And it's going to get worse. And we need to know where we are. So today, if you have any decision to make in any manner, don't think that if you come to the prayer team this morning for prayer that everybody's going to go, oh, they're homosexual or lesbian. We have covered several things you could come for prayer for. Maybe just for a headache, okay? So we will not stigmatize anyone who comes. But in all seriousness, if God has spoken to you in any way this morning, I would encourage you to make any commitment you need to or come for prayer. They will be to my right just at the close of the service. Our offering bucket is to my left. Drop in your tithes and offerings if you'd like to be a part of the ministry of this church. And also, if you can stay and visit and eat with us and then go on the little trip later, we'd love to have you do that. I apologize to the bar, and I apologize to you. We went 10 minutes over, but this is front page stuff. This is as current as it can get. And this is God's word to us concerning the matter. God bless you. You're dismissed. Have a great rest of your day.